How you doing?
Hey Samuel, good, how are you?
What's up, my friend?
You well?
Yeah, Andrew Tonks, good to connect.
Yeah, no, likewise. Yeah, I don't think I've actually met you before. Seen a lot of you, obviously, but never met.
Great stuff. Well, listen, man, thanks for your time. I just thought it'd be great to ask you a few questions about property, what you've been up to, and we'll record it. I'll send you a copy, and hopefully it will inspire some people.
Yeah, perfect.
Cool. So what's your background? You've been in the military and stuff.
Yeah, so I was in the military. Well, went school, university, all the normal stuff. Then did 10 years in the military. I was flying helicopters there, which is a pretty cool job, to be honest.
I saw that on your Instagram. It says pilot, and I was like, interesting.
Yeah, well, I try and link them together. You know all about doing brands and stuff. So I sort of think, you know, property, pilot, link them together.
Yeah.
I did 10 years doing that, which is great fun. Spent a lot of time in Afghanistan, which was a bit interesting, some tough times.
Yeah.
But the good thing about that is that we'd go there for like 3 or 4 months at a time and come back with a big wad of cash in your pocket, because you'd only spent about £50 over 3 or 4 months. And most of my mates were buying second-hand Porsches, going on first-class holidays, and I basically started doing a bit of property by accident, basically, which was quite good. So I did that for 3 or 4 years, started building up a small portfolio, and then I was leaving the military and thought, right, I better take this property seriously, because I might not be able to get another flying job, so actually should have a good backup in case. So then basically, the last 3 years, I've been expanding the property business, and it's really taken off the last sort of year or so, which has been great.
Yeah, that's awesome. So up until kind of a year ago, you'd been just a traditional buy-to-let investor, and you'd built up a portfolio with your own money, right?
Yeah, so pretty much, that was up until about 3 years ago, I'd say. And then the previous 2 years before the last year, I was building up nicely, but, you know, made a few mistakes, as people do. They're all rectified now, thankfully, which is good. I went from buy-to-lets and then moved on to some HMOs, rent-to-rents, you know, a few more creative things.
Yeah.
And then I'd done some deal sourcing in the past, but only the last year I've really focused on that a lot more, just because I'm not really sure why, but it's really kicked off the last sort of 6 months to a year, which has just been ridiculous, to be honest.
Yeah. Okay. So what's your portfolio like? What your buy-to-let portfolio?
So buy-to-lets, I've got, well, let me think. We've got 14 buy-to-lets in total. That includes one block of 5 flats.
Yeah.
14 buy-to-lets and one HMO owned. And then I've also got 21 HMO rooms on a rent-to-rent as well.
Fantastic. So I'm really interested to talk to you, because you've gone from the traditional buy-to-let property owner and you've built up a healthy portfolio. I mean, does that generate decent income?
Yeah, no, it does generate good income, which is nice, to be honest. And it's worked out well for me.
Yeah. So with your rental properties that you own, what kind of cash flow are you getting off the whole portfolio?
I never think of it. That's a good question. I've not been asked that question for a while. Probably on a good month, it's probably five and a half thousand maybe.
Yeah. And what about an average month?
Average, probably more like 4 to 4.5, because there's always works going on.
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay. So but for most people, that's a good solid wage, right?
Yeah, no, exactly that. Yeah.
It's coming in from rents from your portfolio, which is awesome. Talk to me about the transition from traditional buy to let, because now, I mean, I see you now on Instagram and stuff, you're doing like rent to rent, deal packaging, all these strategies that are creative, that the stuff that I teach, I know you're a fan of my YouTube and stuff and watch a lot of the videos, it's awesome. But like, talk to me about that transition.
Well, it's a funny one, because most people just tend to do the boring buy to let, don't they? And it's not boring, I love it. I want to keep getting more because they're nice and safe.
Yeah.
For me personally, I was leaving the military, going to be an airline pilot. And, you know, as you can see right now, being an airline pilot is a bit of a risky job to have. So I thought, how can I get more cash flow quickly, just in case things start to go wrong? So that's where I looked at the block of flats, because I could buy 5 in one go with the same amount of work as buying one, but end up getting more cash flow.
Yeah.
So that took a bit of education. And then doing the sort of rent-to-rent HMOs and buying a HMO, again, just had to get educated, you know, stuff like your videos, books, you know, just to make sure that I was confident, because buying a buy-to-let now for me is easy. You know, if you're buying your first buy-to-let, it's hard, but I thought that buying my first HMO or rent-to-rent HMO, actually, it's a completely different ball game. So I wanted to make sure that I was set up, you know, in the right way with all the compliance and all the documents that I've needed. So it was a bit interesting, but it, I don't know, I think maybe the military training sort of made me prepared for it almost.
Mm-hmm.
Just because, you know, I knew that actually it might be a bit scary, but often if you do something scary, you get good reward out of it. And, you know, you talk about that a lot as well.
Yeah. Yeah. So how many deals are you packaging and selling then these days? What's going on that side of things?
At the moment, well, I was aiming to do one a week this year.
Yeah.
But I think now, I had a look the other day, I think this year we've done, actually because we had two complete yesterday, I think we've already done about 30 this year.
Wow, that's good. That's serious. And yeah. And what kind of amount are you charging on average per deal that you're selling?
So the lowest that I've charged, and I'm quite embarrassed by this, was £400. However, that was helping a mate out and we got a bit screwed over. But yeah. this is a good tip. That then resulted in me helping that mate sell another 5 or 6, which we got a lot more money for.
Yeah.
So it was quite good to help.
What's an average fee?
Well, average fee now, I'd probably say, is somewhere between £2,500 and £3,000.
So if you've done 30, I'm just doing the math, you're talking what, like 75, 80 grand this year?
Something like that, yeah. And the one that we completed on yesterday, which was two HMO PLOs or lease option agreements, that one is, that's 9,000 for the one that we sold yesterday.
Wow, £9,000 for one fee.
Yeah, I mean that's the best one I've done individually so far. But it was
What was it? What was the deal?
It was two HMOs on lease option assignments for 5 years.
Nice.
Fully licensed, partially tenanted, and yeah, you know, the investor was happy. I thought about taking it on myself actually, but it was just a bit out of my area.
Listen, your story is interesting because without the pilot stuff and without the Afghanistan stuff, your story is kind of similar to my story because I built up a portfolio. Now, I didn't do it with my own money. I joint ventured and used other people's money and stuff, but I built up a portfolio quite traditionally, combination of HMOs, single lets. And then I got to the point where I thought, how can I get more money fast? Like, I just want some fast, quick, because you're talking about £5,000 a month from your buy-to-lets. That's okay. That's good. But if you want to get fast money and you want to make a lot more, I thought, how can I do that? And that's when I stumbled across deal sourcing. I didn't know deal sourcing was a thing. No one taught me deal sourcing. I just kind of, you know, I just kind of figured it. And because of my experience in buy-to-lets and stuff, I started packaging and selling deals like you, started killing it with that. Then got into other creative strategies and then used that money that I was making to invest into my portfolio, started doing bigger deals and then grew that way. So that's kind of my story. Interesting as well that we've not met before, because like normally when I get people on my YouTube channel, they're part of my academy or I've met with them.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of the videos, yeah.
Yeah, I've trained them. Whereas with you, we've not met before. So talk to me about that.
What about why we've not met? Or
yeah, why have we not met? You've never come to an event. You've never paid me a penny. You've never done any training with me.
Yeah. I mean, I think I signed up to one of your events in the past, but couldn't go. I mean, one reason actually is before the lockdown, I spent the whole winter in Australia and New Zealand.
Yeah.
My wife just had a baby, so I took a bit of time off flying to do that. So that's probably one reason why I'm not seeing you this year. Before that, I don't know. I've signed up to events, but just stuff got in the way. You know what life is like, and with the I still do fly, and that gets in the way a lot as well.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, it's an interesting one, Andrew, and I'm interested in your opinion on this because I mean, hey, I'm not saying why, as in you should have, and it's terrible.
Yeah.
I'm just curious because I know you've been watching my. How long have you been watching my stuff, my free content online?
Over a year. I read your book as well.
How much has that helped you with what you're doing, with the deal sourcing and all that?
So it's been very helpful. And, you know, one of the things I say, actually, I had my baby last September.
Yeah, congrats.
Especially thanks very much. I know you're a family man as well. But during the autumn last year, you know, and this is God's honest truth, sort of the 3, 4 a.m. feeds, you know, put on YouTube, stick on a couple of Samuel Lee's videos, and, you know, just for a bit of, you know, well, entertainment and a bit of education at the same time.
Yeah.
I found I needed something to keep me awake enough, where some traditional videos maybe aren't quite as, you know, entertaining. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, because it was a nice mix.
Well, they were quite here's the debate, here's the discussion, kind of the thing that I want to talk about, which is interesting. Because a lot of people ask me the question, they say, you know, why do I need to pay for training when I can just do your online stuff? Because I put out a lot for free. And people sometimes say you're too expensive. I'm having Joe Lycett right now on Channel 4, you know, taking the mickey, saying I'm really expensive. I have a lot of people saying that. My customers don't say that, ironically. You know, nearly all of my customers, the statistics are over the moon, love the training. But the people that are on the outskirts that are looking, go, that's expensive, and then try and take the mickey. And my argument, and I'd love to know what you think, as someone that hasn't paid me a penny, my argument is, listen, I want every single person to be able to benefit from my training. So I'm going to do my books, my crash courses. I'm going to do all my YouTube videos every day for free. I'm going to then, if you want a bit of mentoring, a bit of coaching, we've got Samuel 365, which is £95 a month. And then if you want to go the full hog and you want to do all my courses and all my training, if you do everything together, it's £12,000. And that's for people that want to do it. Now, I think that there's value in that. If you're starting out and you want to go from 0 to 100 and you want to figure everything, you want to learn everything.
Yeah. And
for you, when you stumbled across me, you'd already built up a large portfolio. So you had a lot of that foundational stuff. So then transitioning into deal sourcing for you isn't such a big deal, because it's like, well, I've done it myself for the last X number of years.
Yeah.
So I just think it depends on the person. For some people, most people wouldn't be able to do what you've done and just start deal sourcing and make 75 grand so far within 5 months with no proper training. I don't think that's feasible for most people. I think most people would need some advanced training, some guidance.
Yeah, right.
But like, I don't know. What do you think about the whole debate and the whole topic as someone that's benefited from my free training that's never actually paid me? What's your response to these Joe Life characters?
So my thought would be that it depends on the person purely. I think for me personally, because maybe of my military background, I've always been a bit of a go-getter, you know, probably like yourself. So I'll, you know, suck up the information, and I'm not afraid to take a jump and go for a bit of a risk.
Yeah,
maybe that's because I've got the previous portfolio or, you know, my flying job. But I think because you put out so much information, there's actually enough stuff to get you started there. And then I fell back on my previous experience. And that might work for some people. I think others, you know, often you can get all the free information, but to actually take the leap, because it is scary.
Yeah.
Actually, I think you often may need your handheld, or, you know, if, you know, having your handheld isn't enough, maybe a bit more guidance, actually someone, you know, mentoring you, you know, like you offer, to sort of help them properly through the process to get started, and then they can continue to build on that. But I think it just depends on the person, and, you know, how dedicated they are, how motivated, and how much experience they've got, and, you know, how much work they're willing to put in as well, because I think that's probably the main thing.
Yeah, and I think it's an interesting discussion, and I appreciate your feedback on it. Like, I pay my personal trainer to come around my house every day and train me. Now, the only reason I pay him for him is for accountability, because if he doesn't come around my house, I'm not doing push-ups. You know, so I pay him a good salary, and that's just for accountability. So I feel with my, I know you've not done my advanced training, so it'd be hard to say, but with my training, accountability, and people say, oh, it's all online for free. Everything's online for free.
Yeah.
In that case, there's no point for Harvard University. There's no point for anything. Why go and learn to be a doctor? Because you can find it for free. But there's so much crap online. Filtering through the crap.
Very hard.
I'm just like, you know what? Now forget that. I'm going to go to a proper trainer that's actually done it. Have you done any training?
Yeah, I have done some, but that was 2017. I did some, yeah.
How much did you spend?
On that, I spent, it was about £15,000.
Oh, so you have done training?
Yes, I did some back then, yeah, but there wasn't really any specific deal sourcing training in that.
Well, the thing is, though, when you are a property investor and when you're making money yourself, being a deal sourcer is actually kind of easy because it's just like, I know how to find good deals. I'm experienced myself. I know how to put together a power team. I know how to talk to agents. Now all I have to do is just figure out how to actually pass this on to an investor and charge a fee. That bit is basic business sense.
It's basically just, you know, a little bit on the side.
Yeah.
Then you can do what you've done in the past, what I've done, and actually make it more than a bit on the side. And then when you focus on it, it does, you know, end up becoming more than that because you can make good profit from it.
What have been the biggest mistakes that you've made over the last however many years you've been investing and doing property?
Biggest mistakes? I've jumped into deals before where maybe I didn't do quite enough due diligence.
Yeah.
And they've thankfully worked that all right, but just been a lot more work.
Yeah.
I'd say that. And I'd also say probably not asking for help enough, because I'm a bit of a proud person. Maybe it's the military. I don't know, but it's probably just me personally. But I think if you're struggling with something, if you ask for help from someone more experienced or someone who's just done it before, then actually that's a real powerful thing. It can help you out a lot and probably save you a lot of money as well.
That's a really good point. I think one of the big advantages that I had when I started was I was so young, I was unashamed to just say, I don't know what to do.
Yeah.
No, I'm a teenager. I've not got a history of you know, family, generational property investors. I'm starting out. So I'm all right to just be like, I don't know what to do. I'm all right to say, what does that mean? But I feel that pride can actually really hinder you. So that's an interesting point.
Yeah. And there's no such thing as a stupid question either.
Yeah. Yeah. What's your goals over the next sort of 6 months of the year?
So looking to continue the deal packaging, but that's basically to fund more properties. But I'd like to double the size of the portfolio, I think.
Yeah. Where are your houses? Where are they based?
All in Manchester or Greater Manchester, which is where I'm from, even out of London. So I think, doubling the portfolio with either purchases or lease options is the main aim, really.
That's good. That's really interesting. So what's been the biggest kind of learning point then? If you were speaking to your younger self that was just starting out in property, what would be the biggest tip you could give?
I would say biggest tip, build up the cash flow first of all, because without the cash flow, you can be looking around for big deals or really exciting stuff. But if you've not got the cash flow, you know, be it from deal sourcing, some rent to rents or some other nice deals, then actually, you know, you could be doing big deals or whatever, but because you've not got the cash flow, you go bust and you've got to start again.
That's so true. And talk to me about the difference between, for anyone that doesn't understand, for the difference between cash and cash flow. So savings, because when you say, oh, building up cash flow, some people think in their mind that means saving up money. Whereas cash flow is a different thing. What's the difference?
Yeah, so, well, cash is just money you've just got sit there. It's not earning any profit or any interest on it, anything like that. Whereas cash flow is regular money coming in each month. It's almost like the blood running through your veins. Comes in every month. It keeps you ticking over.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know what's really interesting as well? I think that no matter what happens to the property market, people say, what's going to happen to houses? You know, it's looking like they're going to go down. But what's going to happen? And ultimately, if you've got properties that are giving you good cash flow, whether they go up, whether they go down, it actually doesn't matter that much.
No, exactly. You know,
when you buy cash flow instead of I'm hoping for capital appreciation. Listen, capital appreciation doesn't pay the bills.
No, exactly. You know, I buy for cash flow, and then capital appreciation is a bonus.
I think so. And there's so many investors right now that are freaking out because they think the property prices are going to go down this year. My attitude is, it doesn't matter if they go down, as long as, because the rents aren't going to go down.
No, they're going to. They may even go up.
I think they will go up, and HMOs particularly. I mean, you know, you're buying HMOs and stuff. I think that as people struggle and as people lose jobs, they're going to be forced to have to downsize into HMOs. And I think HMOs are actually going to become very, very popular and in demand over the next couple of years.
Yeah, no, I think you're right on that one.
Yeah. So what would you advise best strategy then? If you're starting out, like you started very traditionally, you also were fortunate that you were able to have income. You had a good income from working in Afghanistan, which got you started in property. But if you're starting out from scratch and you've got no money whatsoever, like, I mean, you know my training. I'm like, I started with nothing at 17 and I don't teach the slow 10-year plan. I teach actually, you know what, if you put the effort in, you can get started quickly, even if you've got very little money. I mean, what would be your advice to someone starting out? What do you think?
Starting now, I think the best, and it's a perfect time for it, the best thing to do would be to focus on lease options and rent-to-rents, be it HMOs or maybe later in the year service accommodation. Get some of them because you get the good cash flow. And especially if you get the lease options, then you can be building up your long-term portfolio as well.
Yeah.
And you know what? Any deals that don't suit you, sell them on, because then you'll be able to get enough money to fund the next deal as well.
Yeah. And most people don't understand lease options and rent-to-rents. Like, it's an absolutely... And some people that don't understand them, I see people even in like... in the comments and stuff on YouTube saying, oh, you know, that's a scam, that's not legit. And it's like, listen, don't talk about something that you don't understand. Because to say that, if anyone that tells me lease options are a scam or they're not legit, is clearly someone speaking out of ignorance that just hasn't done it.
Yeah, I mean, lease options are really common abroad. They're really common in commercial property as well. They've been around for a long time. It's just that in residential, they're not as popular, but I think they will be now.
Yeah, I mean, unless you're in Scotland, if you're in Scotland, different story. But the rest of the UK. So what is a lease option?
So it's a lease option agreement or purchase lease option. It's where you agree a set purchase price with the vendor, say in 3, 5, or 7 years time. And then in the interim, you will pay them a lease fee monthly or however you agree to service, you know, their mortgage debt if they've got it, or just to pay them a little bit of profit. And then the way you make it work is that you turn that into maybe a HMO or SA, or you maybe do a little bit of a refurbishment and put in better tenants.
Yeah.
You do something to make a bit of profit on top. And then during that 5-year period, or at the end of it, you'd maybe choose to buy it yourself, maybe renegotiate, or maybe actually what some people do is agree to sell it on to somebody else for a slightly higher price and then make a bit of capital profit in between.
Yeah. And it's amazing how long like 5 years is, because People might be thinking, oh, I don't want to secure a lease option agreement now because house prices are going to go down. Listen, house prices are probably going to go down, yes, over the next year or so, quite possibly. But 5 years is a long time. Like, when I did some lease option agreements in 2009, and in 2009, property prices were absolutely rocketing in the Midlands. And everyone was saying, oh, they're going to crash. It's like, actually, they kind of already have crashed. And then within a year or two, they started shooting up. And after 5, 6 years, when I came to complete on my lease option agreements, that some of them had almost doubled in value.
Exactly.
Like, it's just crazy how...
Go on, sorry.
I was just saying, it's crazy how people's predictions can be so wildly wrong.
I think it's just a fear. You know, that fear often scares people from taking any action. And, you know, if you're scared of that, I'd say on any lease options, make sure they make a monthly profit and you get your cash flow going.
Yeah.
And then again, the capital gain is just a bonus on top at the end.
Yeah. As an experienced investor that's got quite a large portfolio and has done it without my training, like you started watching my videos a year or so ago, and it might have helped you on the creative side with deal sourcing or whatever, but like, is there anything that I teach, is there any strategies which you're like, oh, I fancy a go at that, but I've not done it yet, or you think, I don't believe that's not legit, or anything like that?
I did like your recent videos about sourcing during lockdown, because I've done a bit of it myself, but I thought, God, you're a bit more confident than me. Because it's not really a strategy, but I think from a lot of your videos, when you'd be like, right, I'm going to get a deal today, and almost, you know, I think the way you set yourself mini targets, you know, and it can be for any sort of deal. But I think that is, that's something I'd say. But in terms of what you're doing, have you lived in a purchase in a lease option?
No, I've never lived in one now.
And I don't think so. That's something I might look at in the future. But no, I think it's the fact that you're doing so many different things. It's, you know, trying to keep up with you. I'm trying just to do a few things at a time.
So, you know what I can say about lockdown, but you've killed me, dude, in lockdown. I mean, you've been out selling me with the deal sourcing side of things. I mean, it's not something that I really focus on too much, but honestly, you say you've sold 30 deals so far this year. Dude, pretty much... we're not even halfway through the year, and pretty much the whole of this year has been in lockdown almost. Like, the corona thing kicked off in sort of February, March time. Yeah. March, things started getting really difficult. April, we were locked down the whole of April, the whole of May so far. So I think you're doing really seriously well. And it's also interesting that people are still buying right now.
Yeah, no, because as soon as coronavirus kicked in, I thought, oh, that's it, game over. And I had a little moan to myself for a day or so. And I thought, this could be bad here. But
yeah, you know, what are your investors looking for? What kind of properties are they looking to buy?
So up until last week, they were wanting tenanted HMOs or long-term lease options on buy-to-let or SA or HMOs.
Mm.
Whereas this last week, people have started looking again for service accommodation as well.
Yeah.
And then there's still a few people looking for land deals, but I keep them separately because they're a bit, the development stuff is a bit more complicated and a bit more long-term.
Yeah.
Anything tenanted and anything long-term, people will go.
Yeah, that should be your next challenge though, Andrew. Big deals, land, development.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm looking at, you know, now that I've got the other systems in place, I think, you know, because, you know, one big land deal either for myself or sourcing it on, you know, could be a year's worth of pay basically in one deal.
My advice generally to people, and it'd be interesting what you think of this, but maybe this will be my advice to you even, would be, I think, start off by a small deal. For your first one, because number one is if you haven't got landlord experience, you're going to struggle with the finance. Number two is a small deal. You're probably going to make mistakes on your first deal. It's going to be better to make mistakes on a small deal. So do a small deal to begin with, maybe like a little single let. Then do a slightly bigger deal. Then a slightly bigger deal. And every time you buy a house, let it be a bigger deal. And then once you've got five or six, maybe sell those first couple that you bought. And then put them towards the next bigger. And just get bigger and bigger and bigger. Because the because it's just as much effort to do a big deal as to do a small deal, but you just add an extra zeros on the end.
Yeah, no, agreed. You know, you'll have the same power team involved. Maybe paying the architect a bit more, you know, project manager a bit more. But actually, yeah, it's not much more effort for a lot more reward. And I think you have to cut your teeth with the small thing. You know.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
With small deals, even with the packaging, you have to cut your teeth with just selling, you know, a really small SA or buy-to-let deal, to be honest, just so you can learn the ropes.
Yeah.
Because also you need to know what you're talking about as well. If you're trying to buy a portfolio or a big block of flats or something, or do a big development deal, if you go and chat to the agent or vendor, you don't know what you're talking about, they're gonna kick you out in a hurry, aren't they?
Yeah. Dude, that's awesome. I'm really excited for you. I mean, what would be your final words of advice to anyone watching this that wants to get started in property or is interested in doing more, being more? What would you say?
So I say two things. I'd say make sure you're educated, first of all. Either, you know, if you can just look at the free stuff, great. Otherwise, get some education from someone like yourself or you know, a good training company, because without the education, I mean, I take it back to my job. I'm a pilot, right?
Yeah.
You know how to fly a plane?
I don't know how to fly a plane.
Okay.
I'm sure you can learn from free. Just jump in. Still though, not a good move. You're going to have a crash.
No. That's it. But so would you jump, if I said to you, here you go, Samuel, here's the keys to my plane, would you try and give it a go?
No, never.
Exactly. So that's why you need to get trained and educated. So I'd say do that. And then secondly, I'd also say just be persistent and, you know, and keep on going, because the compound effect, I found it in the deal sourcing, you know, find it with other strategies. If you keep on going, keep on learning, eventually the rewards will come, and you know, they'll come. Because the problem is, I think a lot of property investors start after a year, they've not achieved anything, but yeah. Give it 2, 3, 4, 5 years. And all the guys have been in property for a long time, you know, like yourself, they're all doing well because they've stuck at it and the compound effect.
So true. Persistence is absolute king. And also I love your analogy about the plane. Here's my opinion as well. I have to say it because of all this stuff that people are saying, oh, you can do it all online for free. Yeah. All right. Do it online for free then. I'd do it. I put it out deliberately online for free so that you can do it online for free. But the thing is, if you take something really seriously, you're going to pay.
Yeah.
You wouldn't watch YouTube videos on learning how to fly a plane and then go and try and fly a plane. Why not? Because you value it and you don't want to crash. You really value this. And in the same way, if you're going to half-ass property, oh, you know, I'll have a little go, I'll watch a few videos and have a little go, then fine. But if you want to really take it serious and get really serious results and learn properly, then pay. And listen, I don't care. You do whatever's best for you. I'll give you both options. But don't have a go at me for charging when you want me to spend time with you. Like, come on, get real. Joe Lycett, do you know how much he charges? He's dissing me, saying I'm too expensive. He charges £20,000 for a 10-minute speech. How much value is in that? How much value is in that compared to £10,000 to learn every single course there is about property over a 12-month period? It's just like, I can't believe people's audacity.
Yeah, you know? It's just, wow. I don't know, I find it strange because, you know, having paid for education, you know, separate to your stuff, yeah. But I find it, if you pay for something, you often value it a lot more and you're more likely to succeed as well because you've paid for it and you're going to work hard.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Sometimes if you've just got the free stuff, you know, what's the value of free stuff?
Yeah.
You know, some people, they don't say it's valuable at all. And they may not put it in, whereas actually if they put a stake in the ground, paid some money, you know, got some accountability, chances are they're much more likely to succeed as a result.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Dude, I appreciate you, bro. Thank you for your time. Keep smashing. Drop me a message on Insta anytime. And don't pay Joe Lycett £20,000 for a 10-minute speech because you can watch him for free.
I don't even know who he is, so I'm not paying.
Oh, dude, you can watch it on you can watch the show, but you'll have a good chuckle. It'll be good fun. But you want to get rich, then just stick watching YouTube videos with me.
Yeah, no, cool. Yeah, I'll check him out. Thanks very much, Daniel. I'll
check him out, but don't pay him £20,000. Just watch it. His jokes are for free online. It's fine.
I'll put it on some properties instead.
Yes. Peace out, bro. Much love.
Okay.
See ya.